per se, there is always a very big debate. But of course, when you're looking at the classification of the Vedas, you're looking at the classification of the epics, you're looking at the classification of Puranas, to a certain extent, there has been some kind of consensus date, if I may say so, isn't it, Mandiri? Approximately, there is a consensus date that we can look at. But when we're looking at Sangam or Chankam, it begins, in fact, mythology begins with the Chankam period itself. Because every particular Chankam, as you know, this young lady very beautifully said, there are three Chankams. Of course, during the course of my slides, we will discuss all of that. The three Chankams itself spread over about 2,500, 3,000 years. And each of those Chankams was presided, say, by a very famous sage called Agastyar or Agastyar. You will see Agastyar playing a very predominant role in the Mudal Sangam, which is the first Chankam. You will see Agastyar playing a very important role in the second Chankam. But in the second Chankam, you will see a person called Tholkapiyar, who wrote the very famous Tamil grammar book called Tholkapiyam, was very important. Third Sangam, you have another person, another great scholar, who's written so much about Muruga, Nakya. He becomes a very important person in the third Chankam. So the problem that we have in the space of history, mercifully, since it's mythology in the sense of constructing religion, I don't have to get into the political spaces, and I would like to thank Professor Madhuri for that, because that is a very scary, that's a very tough zone to deal with. Now, when I went to Madurai Meenakshi Temple, there is a fantastic ASI publication there about the entire temple, and they have done a very beautiful work on the various Pandyan kings who ruled there. But again, when you're looking at Madurai itself, Shilamba Pandya, you know, when you're looking at Pahan, how this particular Pandyan king threw his axe to say that the river goes away, etc., again you would notice the importance of mythology and mythical elements that is coming in. So the point I'm trying to tell you, my friends, is Chankam period itself, the literature itself that we are using to construct the mythology, your mythology begins from there, is the point I'm trying to make. Now, there is this classic work written by Thiruvalluvar, Thirukkural, written by Thiruvalluvar. That particular text is very much published, it's very much in the public space. But again, who was the person who wrote Thiruvalluvar, what was his date, etc., what was his lineage, etc., we still do not have a very clear, explicit idea. This is maybe because of the de-linking between archaeology as well as literary sources. So Chankam itself begins the phase where you are already on this vehicle or the vimana of mythology. Right? Now, as far as Indian culture goes, now since I'm a teacher, maybe not a teacher, I think in front of the great scholars, in front of, especially the scholar who's sitting in front of me, I mean, as a student of this particular subject, I mean, which is, and studying ancient India, especially from 4500 BC to about 12th century AD, is not a joke. And when you're studying that particular phase itself, you realize that there was this dealing between timelessness and any particular character, whether you're looking at epics, whether you're looking at Puranas, whether, for that matter, even if you're looking at, say, the birth of Buddha, you know, in that sense, Gautama, itself, there is so much of mythology and myths that are associated. Now, that symbiosis or that kind of an amalgamation between events and mythology, we can't disassociate. But the point I'm trying to make is, in Chankam, it begins with the classification of phases itself. Okay, am I on the same page? Are we all together? Okay, now, in Sangam literature, you would notice that there is this, as this young lady very beautifully said, there is a large collection which is called as Pattupattil and Ettuthogaiyil. And the total number of poems that is there is about 2,381, and 102 are known, the rest is attributed to 473 different poets, some of them who are kings and women, etc. So, one thing that is very beautiful about the Chankam literature itself, you would notice, is that there was absolutely no difference that was given, so to say, between people coming from different walks of life, as well as to people who are in the space of especially there was no gender difference. Ladies also had the right to contribute. Now, for example, since we have to construct mythology that is based on Chankam, it is important for us to know what the Ettu Thogai is. Ettu in Tamil means aid, Togai basically means the translation of idylls, I-D-Y-L-L-S. That is small little anthologies is what that would mean. For example, there is this particular text which is called as Naranai. That is, it deals with the five Thinnais and the theme of love. It was compiled by the patronage of the Pandyan king, Marava Guru. That is, you have those references there. And again, when you're looking at Sangam literature, the later slides we will be discussing that, the entire land was divided into five spaces, which is called as Thinnais. So depending upon the geography, the religion, the mythology, the philosophy, the culture, the language developed. It developed according to that. Now, for example, there is in Attithogai, there is this other book called Kurunthogai. It is a collection of short lyrics on love, patronage of a chieftain called Kuriko. That is, this is very interesting. The poems were again classified into two categories, which is Akam, which is inner, and Kuram, which is outer. Akam deals with the inner life of the individual, his relationship to, with family as a lover. Kuram is interactions with members of the society at large. The 18 works is called as Padinet Pillambu, as well as Tagadu Yattarai and Muttalurayam, along with two other epics, which all of us are very aware of these two epics, which is Shilaparikaram and Manimegalai. So the largely what is really Sangam literature as such, if you really go to see, there is a little bit of a controversy in this sense where some of the scholars actually believe that Manimegalai, Shilaparikaram and Tolkapiyam actually belongs to post-Sangam. What is a real Sangam literature would be this Attithogai and Pattupatra. That is what they actually consider as the real Sangam. Thirukkural is another classic work that deals with, of course, Thirukkural, Thiruvalluvar, it's something that even today if you go to South, you go to Tamil Nadu, and people who speak Tamil who are, they would just quote Thirukkural just like that. My mother does that. I mean, for her, Thirukkural is very much on her, and I find a lot of similarity between the texts like Thirukkural as well as the Dhammapada. Because in very short lines, in just about 2-3 lines, you know, deep philosophy is actually spoken about. And if you read the Thirukkural, I've got the copy with me, maybe later after the lecture, you can just go through the text. It's a fantastic version. And if you're looking at Chilapadikaram, written by Ilam Vadigal, claimed to be a Chera prince and the younger brother of Shanguttuvan, it is the first known record of what we know as Muttamil. Tamil, Iyal, Isai and Natakam. So Iyal, Isai, Natakam becomes very important. Now, I need to just bring in a context here. Now, when we're studying Sangam literature in the context of the development of Indian culture itself, I think this becomes very important. Why? Because if we are looking at 2500 BC, so to say, in the sites of Harappa, then one needs to also see what is 2500 BC in Tamil Nadu. And if you are trying to say that rivers are the rhythms of Indian culture, if say you are looking at the major water systems like the Indus and its five tributaries where the sites of Harappa has come up, then even in the south of India you had Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, Narmada, we had all those rivers here, Tungabhadra. So what was happening in this part is something that one needs. Going back to Ramayana, I'm pretty sure you must have had some lectures there. If you are looking at the entire space of Lanka or Ravana, you would notice how Lanka was made. In fact, we have the whole episode, the whole description of in the Sundarakandam, where Hanuman has to actually set fire to the entire city of Lanka. He actually feels bad. And there's a whole description of Lanka here. We have Professor Ma'am here, and I don't have to get into that space at all because they're the descriptions of the cities. So how is it that those cities develop? Obviously, it has not happened overnight. So Chankam literature also helps us to connect in the entire cultural ethos in the larger perspective. Now, Manimegalai is a Buddhist epic written by Sethalai Sathanar and it's a sequel to Shilaparikaram. It is a story of Manimegalai. Now, just to tell you a little bit about the story of Shilaparikaram. Shilaparikaram talks about this fantastic story of this lady by the name of Kannagi. Now, Kannagi also, there is a mythology to it, slightly a gory kind of a mythology where it talks about, anyway, not to get into details, but the fact is Kannagi speaks about how, she, Kovalan, comes from this city called Puhar, which is a very famous, popular trading town, and they get married, but then Kovalan falls in love with a dancer by the name of Madhavi. right? I think all of you are aware of this story. So she, and then of course he goes, spends some time with her, maybe lots of time with her, and then he also loses, squanders all his money. But then Kannagi, being the dutiful wife, waits for Kovalan to come back. When Kovalan comes back, she accepts him. And then after that, they have no money. So they decide to go to the city of Madurai. Now, in the city of Madurai, has been described. So we get references to the city of Madurai, not only in the text of Shilapadikaram, but also in one of the texts, which is part of Chankam literature, which is called as Madurai Kanchi. Even there is a whole description of Madurai. And when you study how Madurai was described there, it is like you think, well, this is like any popular, highly urban kind of city. Anyway, so they go there and then finally they want to start off. Just fast forward the story. She will take her shilambul because they have been something to work on. So she says, you take my shilambul. Reluctantly, Kovalan takes the shilambul, goes to the goldsmith. The goldsmith is a crook. He's actually stolen the queen's anklet shilambul. So he decides, he keeps him waiting. He runs to the king. The king, Nedunjaya, I think my memory serves me right, is the king who immediately says, you have to bring him, and he is beheaded. So at that time, they're staying in a person's house, you know, a neighbor. The neighbor sees the crowd, goes and sees, these people just came yesterday, what has happened to this person? He runs, tells Kannagi. Kannagi at that particular point in time was in Ekavastha. She's just had a bath, her hair is left loose. And immediately, she runs to the central area of Madurai. And by the time she reaches, the Chalavadikaram says that this Shivji Kovalan was already beheaded. So Kannagi is very upset, she is in rage. Very similar to the kind of imagery that comes to your mind, like Draupadi, Vastravanam, it's a very similar imagery. She walks up to the gates, and there usually the two Dwarapalakas are there. They look at her and she just pushes them, and in fact she says, hey, where is your king? You know, very ruthlessly she walks in. The king looks at her and says, who is this? Oh, that thieves one. So she says, how dare you call me? I'm not, you know, my husband is not. What proof do you have? In fact, if you want, there are lovely translated versions of this, and the easiest translated versions for that matter for this particular section, you can refer to Wonder That Was India Bhasha. In the section on literature, the translated version of Shilapadikaram has been given very beautifully, very, very beautifully. Of course, there is also, you have this in the anthology of Indian literature, you have the translated versions there, but this is for a very good reference. So she goes there, she takes the shilambul, she breaks the shilambul, and it turns out these gemstones which are there in her shilambul is very different from the gemstones that exist in the queen's shilambul. Immediately the king feels bad because dharma is considered to be very important. Raja dharma, so he feels very bad. Anklet, shilambul is anklet. So he feels very bad, so he falls down, he dies immediately. But the story doesn't end there. Kannagi is full of rage, she's angry. So the first thing that she does is she apparently tears her breast away, she throws it away, and then she decides to say that the entire city of Madurai should go up in flames, and accepting the young and the old. And by the time what happens is Madurai Meenakshi, presiding deity of the city, comes down and, you know, asks her to calm down and you know, asks her to have this Shanta Bhav. And of course, their references, see, this is the problem. The references then we keep getting is very, 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 very different. There are some sources which tell that she goes off to a hill and she starts meditating out of complete sorrow. And after which, of course, she passes away. And the story goes that Illangu Adigal was apparently going to that particular area. And the locals then tell him about this particular story. And that is how Illangu Adigal writes his book, Shilapadikaram. So when you're looking at mythology, Shankam itself, at every turn, it's a very challenging space. At every turn, it is nothing but a beautiful combination between mythological stories, local customs, traditions, and maybe the kind of beliefs that existed. Manimegalai is the phase two. And of course, Manimegalai is the daughter of Madhavi and Kovalan. Madhavi is very upset, she joins the Buddhist Sangha. And Manimegalai also, the story goes, she is actually, there is a king who's very much interested in her, but then she decides that is not the path that she wants to walk. So she also becomes a bhikkhuni. So Manimegalai, so when Shilapadikaram is full of social, economic, and factors and all the Navarasas that you see, Manimegalai is a text that helps you to look inward. So again, the whole division of the Chankam literature that you see, yes, that is also seen very, very beautifully. So you would see that, So, Puri Neru is another famous Sangam text, collection of poems from 100 BC to 220 AD. Maybe after I finish with my PowerPoint, I have these lovely translation versions of these textual material of these Sangam literature, just for you to have a feel of that. The culture that it is divided in the, it's been thin ice, Kurinji, Maruram, Palai, Mulai and Vedan. The Kurinji is actually the entire mountainous region. Now Kurinji also, even in dance, we have, you know, as a folk dance, there is this particular dance that is done, which is called as Kutrala Kurinji, where they say Pachamalai Paramalai Yengaladu Nadu. You know, it's performed at the end, saying that this particular Kurinji comes and she starts dancing and she says that beautiful land with, you know, honey colored water and etc., there's hills which are full of nectar, etc., is my Nadu. And even the way Kurinji comes, she comes, I don't know the exact translation. Like a Kutrala Kurinji is like a tribes woman, you know, her dress, her everything is very typical to that particular space. So in this particular area, this is where it starts, this particular area you would notice that the deities who were worshipped were Murugan, Tirumar, Vendan, which is Indran and Varunan. Kurinji is the mountainous regions, Palai is a desert, Marudam is the agricultural land, Mulnai is a forest region and Nadan is a coastal region. Now there are lots of cultural historians, art historians and of course archaeologists who have worked on this particular space, and most of them seem to say, or they seem to believe that this in a way also reflects the progress of culture from prehistoric to protohistoric period. The deities also, if you see, which we will be doing now, also reflects the change of the transition of man from the food gathering to the food producing stage. The other deities are Kottarai. Now Koravai is another word that is used for her. And fallen heroes, Satis and other martyrs are also defined and worshipped. Now if you are looking at these Sati stones, Satis, Sati Kallu is present even today. Veeragal, Veeragal it's called, or Sati stones. You are from Karnataka. So Veeragal is a very popular kind of stones that are found. And even Sati stones, this is a local custom, especially since I grew up in Telangana region. They would have these stones which is called as Satkas. Now what they would do with the stone, it's just a plain stone. And what they would do is say if somebody in the house is suffering from, say, a sickness, you know, some kind of a chicken pox or swan pox or whatever, they would take that satka, you know, pray, whatever, and what they would do is put that across the, in the road anywhere. So the way that would work is anybody by chance, it's not a very nice thing, would stamp on it, you know, that disease would come on to them. So stones are again very, very important, and I've seen that happening as a child. Another very stones, looking at stones and how stones itself, there is another very popular kind of a ritual that is done, especially in Kerala, which we call as Pachai. It is for Devi, goddess, and it generally is done during the month of the rainy season between June to July, August. That's when, so on a particular tithi is taken. And for this particular ritual, what is fascinating is, you know that grinding stone that we all use, the grinding stone is taken, that is inverted. So when you invert it, that top thing becomes like the head, like the hair, and there is a kandal, silver kandal that is given. It's handed over, just like this Varalakshmi puja, they have this mugam. You know, the Varalakshmi mugam is given. So they would have this kandal that is passed on from one generation to another. They would take that kandal, put it on that particular stone, and the deity or the goddess is then worshipped. During that particular worship, they would use something which is called as Mahavadakku. Mahavadakku is made out of jaggery and rice, and typically that is made by the yajamana of the house. So he would pound it, and the Mahavadakku, and in ghee, it is lit. So stones, the point I'm trying to make, my friends, is as far as stones and etc. goes, we would see the relevance of that even in today's culture, even in today's society. So Sati stones and as well as Veeragallan stones, the antiquity of that can be traced back to a lot of references that we get in Changam literature across the five regions. I would love for Madhuriji, is it okay for me to take questions as I'm going along? If there are any questions, any interaction, I would love, because it's a round table, so anything that you'd like to ask me.
So Sangam literature is based
Hindu or it's Buddhist and
Jain? Oh my God, yes, very good point.
As far as Sangam literature goes, very good point. Now, for example, if you're looking at Chilapadikaram itself, Chilapadikaram, when Kovalan and Kannagi are walking down, when they're going from Puhar to Madurai, they are accompanied by a Jain Muni. At that time, you would notice that she is actually explaining, she is actually talking to them about Jain philosophy. So you would not see again the political history of the period at that particular point in time, Chola as well as the Pandyans. You would notice that the kings also would, you know, it would be a Shaivite influence, a Vaishnavite influence, as well as the Jain influences. And you would also see the influences of Buddhism. Like Manimegala is a classic example. You will see this. Now you will see how Kannagi's story gets very different in Sri Lanka. We will just come to that. It's a very good point. So you would notice that, see, that's again very interesting, because at no point in time, any kind of literature I'm talking about, literature per se, and which is not in the religious mode, sticks to any doctrine. See, Sangam literature was dealing more with the culture of the place, with more the lifestyle of the people, rather than say a specific belief as such, excepting one or two books that we will do right now, which is specifically related to Murugan. Okay, any other questions? Yes.
You mentioned that the first Sangam and the second Sangam were chaired by Sage Agastya.
Yeah, no, first Sangam was Agastya, second Sangam was Tolkapiya.
That was his disciple.
Yes, his disciple.
Now, primarily you look at Sage Agastya as somebody who was from north of the Indus.
Yes.
Now, was this something that actually happened just to bring in some sort of a confluence, yes, or was it? Was it somebody else? I mean, probably they just added this so that you believe that there was some amount of influence from the north on that.
Absolutely, yes. See, Agastya or Agatya itself, who wrote the text Agatyam, even when you're looking at the antiquity of Agastya, for that part, even the Saptarishis, looking from that angle, I don't know whether I could very, very clearly with authentic sources tell you that, you know, Agatya came from north and he made the difference. I don't. And then, see, also the problem also is, then it gets into another loop of, yeah, you know what I'm trying to say. It's the whole north
subduing.
No, the problem is, I guess they would probably be somebody who knew Sanskrit. How would you come into a Tamil area, you know, influence that? So, I don't know, there was something, there was a dichotomy which didn't fit into, like,
see,
you know,
that's precisely what, see, that's the whole point. The point, that's the reason when I made that statement some time back, that when we are studying 2500 BC, it is very important to link 2500 BC to 2100 BC, what was happening in South too. The issue, or maybe the conflict that we have, is somehow whatever that we have been studying so far with due respect has been very compartmentalized. When cultural study cannot be like, okay, this particular scene is over, the next scene begins. There is always a confluence, there is always a continuity. What I think we are trying to do right now is trying to establish that continuity, and believe me, it's very, very difficult, especially when you're looking at chunk of literature. So we hear of Agatya, of course, there are archaeological references, there is a description of Agatya, he says that he is a great musician. In fact, Agatya is very popular even in the Southeast Asian countries. But the fact is, how do we place him in this space? And paradox is, Agatya's contribution as far as Sangam literature, there is nothing.
He's just a chairman.
And he continued through those various phases. Tolkapiya, yes. Tolkapiya, yes. But Tolkapiya again is more grammar. You see?
It's a possibility that Agastya could just have been a generic name, which must have been used by successive people.
Yes.
Continue. So you don't have to be
followed. Yes.
Or probably just say that he was the chairman, so that, yes, given some kind of, yeah, a yellow.
It's more like a Gotra, actually.
Yes.
Yeah. As a name, so you really do have to span another,
yes, you said it. Absolutely, thank you so much. That's really very, very correct. That's the right kind of an observation. For example, Nati Shastra, Muni Bharata, 1 BC to 1 AD. Now, how do we justify? So, Bharata again can be a generic name, and Nati Shastra becomes a base for us to study so much, you know, whether the Angika, Abhinava, Arya, Tathika, religion, dress, position of women, mathematics, everything, in the Tala traditional system. So it is a very tricky question, and I'm sorry, I will not be able to answer this in black and white. Because there is a conflict as far as the debating itself is concerned. So right now the kind of work that has been done is interpreting the literary evidences, studying the literature and placing the literature in front. Which is again, even when you're looking at what happened in the science congress, even when you're looking at the development of ancient Indian sciences, this is where we have a problem. This is exactly where we have a problem. Whether you're looking at the Samhita, Charaka Samhita, Shushruta Samhita, etc., pieces of surgery existed. How do we basically, and then all that gets into mythology. All that gets linked to, say, a particular Deva or a particular Devi. The link becomes, and again, the clarity, you know, we lose out on the historical clarity. To go forward, Palai lived the Kallar and the Marava. Yes, sure.
In the first
time
you have mentioned that there were around 273
boats,
both king and women.
And in the biggest
trend, which
there was the
prevalence of Sati system.
Sati stones.
Sati system was
yes.
What exactly was the status of women in the society back then? I mean, were they liberal enough to
Yes. Now, in this particular space, there is this very great Tamil poetess called Avvaiyar. Avvaiyar has written a lot of work, and her work deals with Lord Ganesha. The mythology that is associated with Avvaiyar also is that apparently she was a very, very beautiful young woman, and she used to write fantastic Tamil literature. And the criticism that was given to her is that most people are coming to listen to her, or she's getting what she's getting because of her. So she prays to Lord Ganesha, and apparently the story goes that she gave up, she requests Lord Ganesha to give up, to take her youth away and to give her old age, so that, you know, people come to listen to her only for her poetry rather than for her, for her physical appearance. So we have one such example. Now, but that whether Avvaiyar, because some sources tell us that Avvaiyar and Avvaiyar's works is very much part of early Chankam, but we have to take it at that particular level. Now, whether Sati stone or Sati as such existed, I'm not sure. But then, in the Chola period, we have such references where if a particular king dies, etc., his very close people used to burn themselves up in flames. And that's a tradition, I think, that is there even today down south, you know, when there's a politician or, you know, they all kind of, they just go and burn themselves, which is actually very, very sad, and which is something that should not be encouraged. Okay, so this is the Palai region. Palai, this is what it is. They planted stones for heroism. They worship this deity called Kauravai. In my later slides, I'll be talking to you about these deities. We will just go through these slides now. And so that you get an idea as to region and to the kind of culture that existed there. Priestesses, oracles, these oracles was called as Salini. Now this kind of, again, you would notice that this is very familiar to, again, people, maybe even in Maharashtra, I'm not sure. Of course, I'm pretty sure it must be happening here too. In Andhra, now since that's the place, Telangana, I grew up, I have myself seen this Sigam. Especially it happens during the time of the Navaratri celebrations, etc., where you have this lady, she will suddenly get into a trance and she will start, so that Sigam is what we call. And in this Sigam, she will dance, she will lend the oracles, and suddenly there will be a bunch of people. That happens even today, by the way. A bunch of people will come, stand in front, and they say, "You please tell me about my house, about my husband, about my children, etc." And she starts, saying, and whatever that she says is considered to be the speech of the goddess. So we find such references, yeah? Kurunji. In Kurunji is where you would say that our Muruga, which is the central as far as the mythology itself goes, Muruga comes in, and the dance was called as Veriyadal or Berandal, and they also, people, I just put this as bullet points, just for us to, for you to know exactly that particular region. And the dance, especially here you see, apparently the sources tell us that Muruga created or choreographed this kind of a dance so that he could entice young, beautiful women. Yes.
right? The Lord of Hills is a board of serpents, reveals himself as devotees and serpents, the head of romantic love and the god. He's called as Shayan. Now, in some of these sources that we get, this is a name that is given to Muruga. I'll go through the slides as far as the regions go, then we will have a quick discussion. Now again, Mullai region, if you see the Mullai region, the various deities who are, the deity who is associated with this particular region, the anthropomorphic representation of this particular deity is very similar to Lord Krishna or Vishnu. Now along with this, you also see Balarama's presence in this particular region. Now again, this is a lot of, again answering, going back to the point that you raised, how do we then equate this, how is it that the, what Krishna skull, was it present, from where did it come? We will leave it where it is at this point in time, because my lecture is on mythology, Shambham literature, right? Yeah. So Marudam is the, here with the god of Indra and Bogi Pandigai. Even today, of course, if you see in during in Sankranti, agricultural land, Bogi is a very important function. So even in the early Shankam literature, we give this importance of, you know, where in the middle of the fields the pot is kept and there is rice that is boiled, etc. In Maharashtra. Absolutely. So the agricultural connects that is seen is because India has always been an agricultural land. In fact, our entire space of polytheism itself comes from the fact that we give so much importance to agriculture. Nayanar. Nayanar is a place where you would see, absolutely, the sea area, you would see all this. And here you would see the god Varuna. Now, if you read the references of how the deity Varuna was worshipped here, it's very fascinating. It was a lot of fun. The worship of Varuna was a lot of fun and excitement, etc. I do not know, I mean, I've not done my research in this particular bit, so I do not know whether I can make that statement, but somehow it reminds me of how our Kolis are, you know, in that sense of the excitement, the gusto, the jaunts and the all of that, you know, you would see that kind of a reference. Yeah, it's not an academic kind of research point I'm making. I'm just making a comparison on what I see. The hunter for crabs and made image and they worship. Here we get references as to how they had made images of the deity and they have worshipped. Now we come to Madurai. Now I have used this Madurai more as an example to tell you how Madurai as a place itself played a predominant role in the space of mythology. Now the submission of the ocean to the Pandyan king, now the Pandyan, in fact there is this particular Pandya, Vilappu Pandya, where he will put his sword and that is how the river, you know, is kept away. And some of the scholars believe that the Sangam itself, the Madurai itself, maybe the entire space was hit by tsunamis. That's what they're saying, that's how the entire space got completely wiped out. The first Sangam, it's called as Talai Sangam, which was at 10th Madurai. Headed by Agathyar, 549 members, 4,449 poets. It lasted for 4,440 years. Patronized by 89 kings. Now this is where the challenges are. Middle Sangam was founded at Kavatapuram, 59 members. Agathyar and Tolkapiyar, 3,700 poets. Lasted for 3,700 years. Patronized by 59 poets. Third Sangam had 49 members, Nakkiyar and Murudala Nila Nangar, and it had about 449 poets, lasted for about 1850 years and 49 kings. Now this is where this is the challenge is what I'm saying. When we are looking at the Sangam period itself, the classification and the literature etc. that existed is a very very challenging space to study. Madurai was a very important Pandyan capital, so you would see that the entire city of Madurai plays a very predominant role for Chankam itself, and Madurai itself is a classic example for the interlink between space and mythology.
Excuse me.
Yes.
How old is Tamil literature?
I was hoping somebody asks me that question. See, the references for Tamil literature.
You are saying written literature, right?
Literature. See, writing. Now let me go back to Father Heras. Okay, now see, there are views about the study of the seals of Harappa, right? Now, Father Heras is of a very strong view that the script which is there on the seals can be traced back to ancient Tamil. Yes. Now, how did it come, Tamil as a language, when did it originate, how did it originate, etc. This is one particular opinion I can place in front of you. Okay. Now, the antiquity of the words of Tamil. Again, we have to go back to this particular space of Chankam literature. And when was this Chankam literature actually written down? That is the three Sangams, especially if you're looking at the time period, you understand the point, right? When it was written down, obviously it must have been patronized by these kings. So, till the time, up until the time that we have some kind of epigraphical evidences to tell us we are speaking, as I'm coming back to that same point again, we are speaking only on the basis of these literary evidences. Yes.
The details of the first three Sangams are not available.
Yes.
Whatever we know is of the final Sangam. The first three Sangams supposed to have been
washed away. Absolutely.
Remember, we did the Kumarikanda.
Yes.
That's where everything was lost.
Yes.
So we don't have any details of the first three Sangams. Whatever details we have is of the final Sangam. So earlier, the Sangams that you just mentioned.
It's been washed away. But sir, what really happens is, in the later Sangams that we are seeing, especially the third Sangam, as far as documentation, see, as far as Indian culture goes, and this is again I'm placing on the basis of the entire cultural study of this country of ours, that somehow by the grace of God, by some miracle, we don't lose our memory. The knowledge of that particular aspect continues down. Date, you know, like this Soul of India, I'm blanking on the scholar who wrote this name, Ryanku, very clearly says, very simple, but it's a very profound statement. Timelessness, Kal. Kal was yesterday, Kal is tomorrow too. Even today we say Indian stretchable time. We never say Indian standard time. I mean, I don't want to trivialize this discussion, but the fact of the case is, there is that kind of a gap as far as timing and time factors go. That's the first point. Second point, also maybe, and ma'am is here, also maybe the deep innate philosophy of our country. Where, you know, it was this whole space when you're creating a sculpture. Now, for example, I mean, here you're breaking our head with literature. I mean, I'm saying even sculpture. For example, our entire Ajanta that we have, or Ellora that we have, our Elephanta that we have. Nobody has actually written the date of the sculptures, dates of those paintings. Why? Because there was this whole thing of create something. You know, there's a rasaswadana, there's a rasanubhava, there is a thought that you're putting across and you have forgotten about it. So why is it that they didn't write? But at the same time, if you're looking at, say, in comparison, you're looking at Egypt. I don't know whether you're studying the other cultures. Definitely, I think you must. An Egyptian culture or the Greek culture, you are actually in a very safe zone. Like my professor used to say, Professor Dhaneshwari, who's taught me philosophy, she says, before the event happened, the sky would reach. Before the event happened, the scribe would reach. Documentation. Here we have only Chitragupta, and again Chitragupta is Yama. Now where do we catch Chitragupta from Samadhi? Big problem. Yama we are all seeing in day-to-day life. Chitragupta is a major problem. Absolutely. Even now, all of us, those of us who are in the teaching profession, whenever we are up for whatever grade, the first thing is start searching for those papers. Because lecture is over, you have forgotten. That happens. Timelessness. And now our university is saying, it's a big problem for a lot of us. It's a big problem because we want to be in a timeless zone. So when Professor Madhuri told me, Dr. Adam, you know, Chankam mythology, I knew I was walking on eggshells. But little bit of the South Indian rasam flavor, you know, I said, let me just bring that particular factor in and venture into this zone with a lot of trepidation. With a lot of trepidation. Right? Now, this is what I told you. Hence, the king came to Venus, Vadiyambalan Panira Pandyan. That is, he was the king who put that spear there and he stopped the coming in of the sea. Now, the features, now, this is where the mythology bit comes in. Nakira belongs to the third Sangam age. He basically spoke about the shrines of God Muruga. He describes the six places of Muruga. Now all these places, mercifully, are all pretty much existing. They are all very popular Muruga shrines. In fact, people go there. And the Palani is again a very important site, a very important place. And plus, we have various gods like Shiva, Baladeva, Vishnu, Murugan, and Yaman, who are worshipped as a part of our Sangam literature. Now, this is one particular bit that I found. Now, there is this particular site, Shalamanana Kuppam near Mahabalipuram, where they have actually recorded a site where, you know, they believe, archaeologists believe, that Muruga worship must have happened. Now, in most of these literature which deals with Muruga, there is a description of Kartikai. Now, here we are slightly on a better ground. Why? Because Kartikai is performed even today. Kartikai happens in the month of December. It is, you know, for the sake of Lord Muruga. Another very popular custom that is performed for Lord Muruga, a very popular festival, is Thai Pusham. Thai Pusham is performed. And of course, these are the various references I have given you where you would see how this particular deity called Kottavi or Paravai is worshipped. And in these texts, in Pattupadu, the mother goddess dances in the battlefield. These are the references that I got from the early Sangam literature, which speaks about, you know, how this particular goddess is celebrated, how this particular goddess is portrayed. And this particular goddess is portrayed in a very, very, very bloody kind of a way. Now, some scholars believe that this particular deity must have merged into the particular deity of Durga. So the point I'm trying to make, my friends, is as far as Chaukam literature goes, two deities come across very clearly. One is Muruga and another deity is this Koravaiamman. That is the Devi cult that we see. Of course, David Kingsley tries to say this Koravai is Chinnamasta. He tries to include that in that particular space. But Koravai as a deity, as a Devi, we will find references to this deity even in the Shilaparikara, where I think in one of my other slides I have put down the references that you get for this particular deity in Shilaparikara. Now, as far as the portrayal of Lord Muruga, you would find, you know, Muruga's six heads in this particular manner, Shat Muruga, and each of his heads or each of his faces actually would be this. Then the places which are associated with Lord Muruga I have put down. I would just like you to take 2 minutes on this particular slide, where it brings out these two wives of Muruga, where it's again a very interesting mythological story that is associated with both these goddesses, and especially with this goddess Valli. Now Valli is actually, she's a daughter of a folk king, of a tribal king, and Valli was very clear that she wanted to get married to Muruga. So the story goes that Muruga tries to entice her, but she doesn't. So finally, the story goes that he takes the help of Ganapati, the story of Ganapati, and Ganapati will come as a wild elephant and chase Valli. Valli does not know what to do, she runs, and then suddenly somebody comes and protects her, and there is Muruga standing there. Now in dance, in Varnam, this is also done very beautifully. It says Swamiye Varachandani Kumara, Swamiye Varachandani. There's a very very famous Varnam that is performed. And in dance, of course, you know, Muruga is portrayed with his old Trishul, his Shikara, the peacock, the Mayura Hasta is portrayed, the veil is portrayed in a very, very clear way as far as the anthropomorphic representations of this particular deity goes. Amudavalli was actually Devyani. The tears of joy of Narayana when he took birth of Trivikarma. So even these wives of Muruga, if you're looking at the wives of Muruga itself, there is a story about their background. So again, if you're looking at it from a story standpoint, fantastic. Mythological story standpoint is fantastic, and that's something which we are not, it's not that it surprises us, because any of our deities, for that matter even kings, you know, have that rounds to their existence. But the point is, but what is interesting is their very visible and active presence in today's society. That is what becomes a absolutely. The Shaya, I just in my previous slide I'm giving you. Kavadi. Yes.
Associated
with. That's basically the Kavadi that is done. And Kavadi also, there is a story where this particular demon carries both the hills and he keeps it down. And for those hills, those are the two hills on which Parani he goes and sits. And again, Muruga, since he is considered to be a deity of the hills, he basically, you know, sits on all these shrines which are all on hilltops. Again, but again, from a cultural standpoint, what this actually means, and I would prefer to go to that particular explanation too, where it also talks about maybe the progress or the transition of man from, say, the food gathering to the food producing stages. So I think that's the point that, and again, a very popular story that is associated with Muruga, which I think all of us are aware of, is the story of Krishna. Yes.
Associated with
the Yes. No, ma'am. In my references, I did not get any stories why he is associated with Valli. The reason why it is the reference that I got was that is why maybe Valli, because Valli is a creeper. Valli means creeper. So the creeper associates itself with the Kadamba trees. So here, of course, talking about this other story, which is again very famous, is that story between, I think that is common amongst all cultures, you know, the story between Ganapati and Muruga, where, you know, that the mango wala story, where he gives the mango and he says, you have to go around the entire world three times. And yeah, yes, and by the time he says no and he decides to, go around his parents, and Ganpati gets and where Muruga is, you know, circulating and he's down, you know, all that. And finally he sees Ganpati sitting and happily eating away there. So, you know, Muruga gets very angry. And Muruga, the portrait of Muruga that we get here is, he was always an angry young man. So he was very angry and, you know, he goes and sits off in Parani. And that's how the Parani Muruga, in that sense, comes into existence. Absolutely. Muruga, oh my God, yes. Muruga, Kartikeya, Skanda, Kumara, yes, all of them are very much the same. They're all the same. They're all synonyms of the same deity. They say, but what is popular in South Indian representations that we see is the names that are associated with Muruga would be Aragan, Balamurugan, Dandapani, Danda Ayudapani, Devasenapati, Chetti, Bahubalyam, Velayudan, in fact, Sarvana. Sarvana is something that all of us are familiar with. Kumaration, Swaminathan, my own Murugan. I came across another term called my own Murugan. And what is fascinating is my own is a name that is associated with Muruga even in the early Sangha literature. So we find those references. Kuranji Veda, we find those references also associated with Muruga.